Ngowi TV, informed economies and business perspective.
Bora kuelewa cha kufanya kuliko kuambiwa cha kufanya.
We Tanzanians, we witnessed a lot of interest from multinational companies.
That is one of the things and initiatives that we would like to have addressed with government in terms of, if you're in the industry, and we're looking for investors.
If it's borrowed well and spent on development expenditure rather than current, it's okay.
Industrialization has failed because accountants did not play their role very well.
Those people who had local shares in the country thought they had local content that supported the people.
And our policy, low volume, high yield.
And tax measures basically is talking about how much the government is expected to collect.
Because when you are borrowing, you are creating liabilities. But then if you turn these liabilities into assets in terms of infrastructure, roads, ports, airports, education, health, that's no problem really. In the long run.
Thank you. I'll try to summarize because again, from 20 to 10 minutes, but you can do it always. So the paper is on education for liberation of the poor, specifically in Africa. And key issues really revolves around Nyerere's thought on education for liberating the poor economically. Those who know me have economics background, so this is my area. And then education for liberating the poor from exploitation of the natural resources. And now there is again a question on the second scramble for Africa, whether it is part of the Africa education curricula, whether really education tries to help poor Africans to emancipate themselves, or rather struggle within the second scramble for Africa. And also, lastly, is on whether education is facilitating this second scramble. The broader context under which the paper is built is the reality that we understand, and I don't need to convince you, that there is a problem of poverty in Africa, but then this is poverty that is happening amidst plenty of natural resources endowment. I could go on and on with a long litany of minerals and all other natural resources in Africa, but time does not allow me to do this. So we are thinking education is a tool for economic liberation of Africa's poor, broadly speaking. And now within the context of the second scramble for Africa, we are seeing this really as the fight for natural resources. And the question is, what is the role of education? I'm skipping really quite a number of issues, but then as I've said, I don't think that I need to convince you that we have problem of poverty in Africa. In major metrics, we find Africa really lagging behind in terms of GDP, in terms of food poverty, income poverty, et cetera, again. But now the question is, when it comes to education, what kind of education that could liberate Africa from this problem called poverty? And of course, now comes the question of education for liberation. And again, this is a central theme in most of Nyerere's work, and in the full paper you could see them, where really for Nyerere the key issue when it comes to education is, seeing education as a primary, primary purpose of education to be liberating people, of course setting them free mentally and also physically for sure, setting one free from impediments of escaping poverty in this context, and of course as a tool that would empower people in Africa to emancipate themselves economically using the natural resources that are widely endowed in the continent, broadly speaking. And of course Nyerere sees education as a lifelong a thing, which should be embraced really what you call a multidimensional orientation. So scholars in the education for liberation space, including Nyerere, of course, see education as this tool that should lead to attainment of self-reliance, issues around that will be, reflected sustainable national priorities, aims, and aspirations. And what does this tell us? Really, it tells us education has to be dynamic, has to change according to the needs of time. The need for education in the 40s, in the 50s, in the 60s is not really the need for education today and maybe 10, 20 years to come. So you could see here, we are talking about education that will be enabling Africans in this context to exploit their country's natural resources. And of course, Nyerere talks a lot, as other scholars will do, on the relevance of education. That education has to be relevant it should be relevant and contextual. Relevant and contextual in terms of time, but also in terms of space. So Nyerere and other scholars, of course, will be talking about, combining, really, having this delicate balance between practical, hands-on, vocational education, along with theory. Nyerere, of course, won't like so much of just elitist education for its own sake, but really education that should be able to solve problems in society. Not education that just gives you a certificate, a piece of paper, but really education that can help one to solve people's problems. So I'll skip really quite a number of details, but I think the full paper can be made available later. But then, again, within this big space of education for emancipating the poor, it should be education, again, that is based on local curricula, and local, sometimes I go to what I call local, to what extent, for example, in Tanzanian context, are homemade? To what extent is education reflecting, real situations at home? So again, in this context, we are not talking about education that is compressed in what we call self-contained compartments, but then we are talking about education that leads into what we call a mental freedom. Mental freedom. Education that enables people who are getting education really to criticize the established authorities, to think outside boxes, those kind of stuff. So to come with critical analysis. But now the question is on whether education in Africa it has been able to liberate the poor from exploitation of natural resources, if I have one sentence to say, I would say no. I would say no. Why? We have seen real education for the past, before colonialism, after colonialism, and of course during colonialism, but then we see still poverty as big problem in the context. I could see when it comes to natural resources, ownership, control, and management, and exploitation, for example, in Tanzania, really we see this mainly being driven by MNEs, multinational enterprises, which undertake foreign direct investment. So we see really, yes, natural resources, we see people have been educated for the past 60-70 years, but still see control, management, and operations of natural resources still being really mainly foreign aimed. If you were to go to the ownership, the management of major mineral mines, for example, in Tanzania, I'm sure it's mainly, it has a lot of more foreign content than local content. So we are seeing, in my view, education has not liberated the poor from exploitation of their natural resources. Why we are seeing so many poor people amidst a lot of education that has been given? So I'll skip again details and go to the question of for example, on whether, another question, whether education is equipping the poor with the skills to exploit their natural resources. Again, I would say no, really. Why? Because, yes, education has been given, but then the kind of education that we have seen in Africa, broadly speaking, and in Tanzania in this context, really it has not been given kind of skills that have enabled people to emancipate themselves from poverty. We are seeing lack of adequate quantity and quality of both technical and soft skills, especially the soft skills part of it. We may have people well educated in chemistry, physics, economics, biology, but then the soft skills have been mainly missing. Issues of teamwork, issues of creativity, innovation, confidence, those kind of stuff. We don't have enough time to go into details into that. So I would say education has not equipped the poor with these kind of skills. That's why partly, really, we still see exploitation of natural resources in Africa and Tanzania, for that matter, being by and large under foreigners in that context. What does this tell me? It tells me partly the people here don't have adequate skills. When I'm looking at the composition of the labor force, if you have to look at the strata, you could see most of companies, top management, mainly really see foreign management. I'm not in any way anti-foreigners, but then this tells me education that has been provided has been inadequate. Now again, I'll skip details because the chair is about to look on at me and go to the second scramble of Africa. And the key issue here is, is it part of education in Africa? Broadly speaking, I was not here yesterday. I was in Ethiopia, so I could not be here. So the key issue we are saying here is when it comes to second scramble, we know the first. Now the second really is this way where we are seeing really still more or less the same who scrambled for Africa many years ago, coming now with the attempt of both countries and multinationals. Now the approach has changed. Maybe in the 1880s, we had mainly countries. Now we are seeing countries and companies in boardrooms scrambling for Africa's resources and influence, and specifically strategic resources. We are seeing them fighting. It's a fight between major competing powers to control new and those resources. Now the key issue here is on whether this education, this new scramble for Africa is part and parcel of education. And again, I would say maybe unfortunately no. We, those of us who went to school in the 70s, in the 80s, I think we had quite a big dose on the first scramble. We read Walter Rodney and how Europe underdeveloped Africa. But now this new scramble, the way it's coming, in my view, it's not really coming out clearly in the new curricula. You know, we did those things in history, we did those in politics, in political science, etc., etc. We did those in economics. But then this new scramble and the way it is taking place, really, I hardly see it being rigorously and thoroughly addressed in our curricula. I'll skip again some of the details to go maybe to answer the question on whether education is facilitating the second scramble for African resources. If I were to conclude, I'm saying really this is inconclusive. Partly the way I'm looking at it, we are seeing that the kind of education being offered in Africa, in my view, may not, and the word is may not be facilitating the second scramble as such. It does not seem to be liberating education that can enable Africans to liberate themselves economically through ownership, control, and management of natural resources. Maybe to conclude, I would say, education in Africa has not liberated the poor from exploitation of their natural resources. And I don't need really to convince you, we still see poverty around. I think the extent of poverty in Africa by many metrics will go around 40-something%, and education has been provided. Now, if this education has been helping people to escape poverty, to graduate from poverty, really, the problem won't be as big as it is today, in my view. And I think this is okay. Africa remains very poor by all metrics while it has abundant natural resources. So education in Africa has not equipped the poor with the skills, both hard and skilled and soft, needed to exploit their natural resources. Now, when it comes to the scramble, the second scramble, again, is largely not part and parcel of the continent curricula. What are we recommending? I would say, given the situation that we are seeing in African education, really there is a need for radical and critical reform of the education system in Africa. And I think we had a conversation with colleagues before. Really, there is a need for radical and critical reforms. But really, we know exactly what it takes. So in my view, I think it's really implementing what we know now. We already know what should be done in education. Now, maybe the question is, why are we not doing it exactly? So education should be adequately provided to provide the needed technical and soft skills that are relevant given context. And of course, here I'm talking very generally, but I understand. If I were to talk to Professor Mbilini, the question of a girl child would appear. The question of education in rural areas would appear. The question of education for the poor would be more specific. So here I'm just really generalizing. So we also need to have what we call a demand-driven versus supply-driven education. The extent to which we who are providing education, to what extent do we consult the market? To what extent are we doing what you call university entrance linkages? To what extent are our curricula addressing and being informed by the industry through tracer studies, through guest lecturers at our universities, etc., etc., etc.? Now, to finish it off, Mr. Chair, I would say the second scramble for Africa, in its very broad meaning, again, should be very important part and parcel, indeed compulsory part of the continent's curricula. We should see and understand exactly the way it happens. I'm sure there are quite a number who may not understand exactly what it is, what it entails in terms of our curricula, in terms of our, contract. Now, the last one is the adequate allocation of all types of resources in the education sector is extremely, extremely important. Without allocation of resources, both financial and non-financial, really we'll be here 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 years to come, and then education will be exactly where it is. To what extent are we really committing adequate resources into education, broadly speaking? And within the budget space, which I discuss a lot, we understand really this is an issue. And the last thing is the question of a political will. You know, all these things, we may speak, we may write, we may come here for Kigoda, for Nyerere Kigoda, for Mwalimu Nyerere's Intellectual Festival, 20, 30, 40 years, but really if there is no political will to see education moving from where it is now to where it should be, it will be, you know, it will be just, papers on shelves and talks like any other talks. So for now, Chair, allow me to move. Thank you.
Really, in the moment.